بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وبارك وسلم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. My fathers, my mothers, my brothers and my sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. Alhamdulillah, thumma alhamdulillah, first and foremost, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all the favors, the bounties, the gifts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon us. And we place salawat and taslim upon the Rabb Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam as a means of barakah. To start off with, just as a gentle reminder to all my fathers and my brothers and my mothers and my sisters, to please make sure that the masks are on, inshallah ta'ala, as a gentle reminder, so that we protect one another in that particular way. We know that things are not looking too good with the rising of the cases. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant all of ourselves and our families and our friends protection. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant those that are sick health. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant those that have passed on Jannatul Firdaus. Amin Rabbil Alameen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أمن خلق السماوات والأرض وأنزل لكم من السماء ماء فأنبتنا به حدائق ذات بهجة ما كان لكم أن تنبتوا شجرها أإله مع الله بل هم قوم يعدلون أمن جعل الأرض قرارا وجعل خلالها أنهارا وجعل لها رواسي وجعل بين البحرين حاجزا أإله مع الله بل أنتم بل أكثرهم لا يعلمون أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء ويجعلكم خلفاء الأرض أإله مع الله قليلا ما تذكرون صدق الله مولانا العظيم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in these various ayat jamaatul muslimin, so much significance to the life and the purpose of a Muslim that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us beautifully of who is the one that is in charge of this world. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts these verses by reminding us and asking us questions. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَمَّنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Who do you think created the heavens and the earth? وَأَنزَلَ لَكُم مِّنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً فَأَنبَتْنَا بِهِ حَدَائِقَ ذَاتَ بَهْجَةٍ. And who is the one that had sent down from the skies rain and water so that it may plant and you will see growing all of these beautiful plants and gardens that is so outstanding. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا كَانَ لَكُمْ أَن تُنْبِتُوا شَجَرَهَا. You would never have been able to plant this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, then Allah asks us a question. أَإِلَهُمْ مَعَ اللَّهِ. Do you think that there's another God with Allah? بَلْ هُمْ قَوْمُ يَعْدِلُونَ. Indeed, these are people that turn away from that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells them. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues and he says, أَمَّنْ جَعَلَ الْأَرْضَ قَرَارًا. And who is the one that made the earth flat? وَجَعَلَ خِلَالَهَا أَنْهَارًا. In the sense of that you are able to walk and you are able to move around upon this dunya. وَجَعَلَ خِلَالَهَا أَنْهَارًا. In between that we find the rivers and we find the seas and we find the water. وَجَعَلَ لَهَا رَوَاسِيَ وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَ الْبَحْرَيْنِ حَاجِزًا. And you see the mountains that is around that is stabilizing and keeps the earth upon where it is. And he had created between the different seas and oceans barriers, as we all very familiar with that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says, أَإِلَهُمْ مَعَ اللَّهِ. Do you think that there is a God besides Allah? Do you think that there is Allah with another Allah? Impossible. بَلْ أَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Verily, very few of them know this because many of them do not know. أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَى. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and who is the one that answers the calling of the one that pleads out to Allah? That pleads out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that calls upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that shouts for help and assistance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, who is the one that other than Allah answers the calling of that person? And not only that, Allah does not just answer the calling of that particular individual, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and he shows to you what is harmful for you so that you may stay away from it.
He shows you what is harmful for you so that you may stay away from it. وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءَ وَجَعَلُكُمْ خُلَفَاءَ الْأَرْضِ. And on top of that, Allah says, and we have made you that you are the successors, the ones that are representing this deen upon of Allah, upon the dunya. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَإِلَاهُمْ مَعَ اللَّهِ. Is other than Allah as a God? Is there anything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a Rabb? And this Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says, قَلِيلًا مَا تَذَكَّرُونَ. How a few of you are reminded and how a few of you remember these verses. The reason I start my lecture today, Jamaatul Muslimin, with these particular ayat, is that when we look at the times that we are facing, it is very difficult times. I never believe that it's dark times, because while the Quran is in our midst and the Sunnah is in our hearts, there's nothing dark of this world. But it is definitely challenging times. It is times where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests not only us as individuals, but the entire ummah. The entire ummah is being tested, Jamaatul Muslimin, in ways that we could not fathom, that we could not understand, and that we never expected it to happen. But this is not necessarily a surprise, Jamaatul Muslimin. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being the creator of everything, subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything, that nothing escapes the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing can overpower the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَعَلِمَ مَا كَانَ وَعَلِمَ مَا يَكُونَ. Allah knows what was and Allah knows what is. وَعَلِمَ مَا سَيَكُونَ, and He knows what will be. وَعَلِمَ مَا لَا يَكُونَ, and He knows what is not. وَعَلِمَ مَا لَمْ يَكُنْ إِنْ كَانَ كَيْفَ كَانَ يَكُونَ, and He knows what is not, how it would be if it did exist. Nothing escapes Allah. Nothing escapes the power of Allah. Nothing escapes the will of Allah. And nothing overwhelms Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in any way. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when speaking about the purpose of this dunya, as we understand the term dunya comes from something that is low, something that is not high. The Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith sahih, الدُّنْيَا سِجْنُ الْمُؤْمِنُ وَجَنَّةُ الْكَافِرِ, that the dunya, it is the prison for the believer and it is the paradise for the disbeliever. And so when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the reason for our existence upon this dunya, Jamaatul Muslimin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةِ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. The one that created death and created life, why, ya Rabbi? Allah explains. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ, so that He may test and see who are those that are going to come out the best. Who are those that are sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Who are those that are actually practicing that which is in their minds and in their hearts? Who are those that is not just theory, but it's practical? Who are the people that are honest and truthful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Because as we said, nothing escapes Allah. No knowledge is, nothing is hidden from Allah. So why is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to show who is the best, or who comes out passing the test? Is so that we may know, where are we with Allah? In this dunya, Jamaatul Muslimin, we strive for different titles and positions. I am worried about who, what am I considered by this person? What does this person think of me? What does my wife think of me? What does my husband think of me? What does my child think of me? What does my mother, my father, my boss think of me? But the most important question that we find ourselves missing, Jamaatul Muslimin, what am I considered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Where am I? Kayfa hali ma Allah? What is my state with Allah? Because I know as a Muslim, that this dunya is not darul qarar, it's not my final destination. I have to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so therefore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that this dunya, it is meant, life, death, it is meant to test us, Jamaatul Muslimin. That trials and tribulations is part of the sunnatul kawn, the sunnah in the universe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had created. And so therefore we do not forget the hadith of the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, when the Nabi alayhi wa sallam said, أَشَدُّ النَّاسِ ابْتِلَاءً الْأَنْبِيَاءُ ثُمَّ الْأَمْثَلُ فَالْأَمْثَلُ, that the ones that goes through the most trials and tribulations. And this hadith we need to ponder, Jamaatul Muslimin, because we have this misconception in our communities. When something bad in our view happens to an individual, automatically we think there's something wrong with him. Now there's a balaa upon. There's this huge cloud that is, you know, over this person. And wallahi, it is not as black and white as we think it is. Because when we look at the hadith that I just merely quoted right now, where the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that the people that go through the most trials and the most tribulations are the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And those that follow them, and those that follow them. And we know for a fact as Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah that we believe that the prophets are infallible and sinless by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we understand that the ibtila is not merely just to show that there's a bad sign, Jamaatul Muslimin. In actual fact, it can come be a good sign for the person, for the mu'min. Why? Because the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam says in a hadith that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ahabba qawman, when He loves a nation or individual or a person, ibtalahum, Allah then tests them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala paces them through difficulties and challenges. And that's why when we think about challenges, Jamaatul Muslimin, it is not only spiritual challenges that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places. No. Whether an individual is transgressing against you or oppressing you or harming you or taking your haqq, that person would never have been able to do that except by the will of Allah. Except by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which does not necessarily mean that Allah is trying to oppress you. Kalla wallahi. It does not mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been unjust to you. The other day when I was on the radio and I mentioned something of this in Aqidatul Tahawiyyah, the person said, Sheikh, does that mean Allah is making it okay for the person to steal from me? No. It does not mean that we justify actions of people and transgressions, Jamaatul Muslimin. But your life, your journey is not about you and the person, it's about you and Allah. Is how am I dealing with the circumstances that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had placed me in? And the greatest example, Jamaatul Muslimin, is looking at none other than the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. We are familiar with the story of Ta'if. When the Nabi alayhi sallam went to give da'wah to the people of Ta'if. And we know how they stoned him out of Ta'if. That the blood was pouring from the blessed body of the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That to a degree that Zayd ibn Haritha, a Sahabiyun Jalil, that the Nabi alayhi sallam had taken in and took care of. He's trying to protect the Nabi alayhi sallam from all the stones that are being thrown at him. And in actual fact, some riwayat, according to Ibn Ishaq, he says that the chiefs of Ta'if encouraged. So when a child would go for a small stone, they say, no, go for that big stone. Throw him with a big stone. Can you imagine, Jamaatul Muslimin? And they threw the Nabi alayhi salam bleeding. Zayd ibn Haritha jumps in front of the Nabi alayhi salam and he tries to protect the Nabi. And because there's so many stones and they're so huge, Zayd ibn Haritha faints because of how they throw him. Zayd ibn Haritha falls to the ground because of how much stones they are throwing towards them. And the Nabi alayhi salam, while he is bleeding, he picks up Zayd ibn Haritha and he catches his blood that he doesn't want it to fall on the floor. He catches the blood. Imagine Jamaatul Muslimin. When it was asked, Ya Rasulullah, why did you do that? And he said, I did not want the land to be cursed. Because a people that harms and hurts and sheds the blood of their Nabi, their land will be cursed. And Nabi alayhi sallam says. So he's protecting the people that are harming him and attacking him. And on top of that, he's also saving Zayd ibn Haritha. And he leaves, he makes it out of Ta'if. And the Nabi alayhi sallam now turns. And Jibreel alayhi sallam comes. And Jibreel alayhi salam says, Ya Rasulullah, I have the angels of the mountains with me. And by the permission of Allah, if you want him to have these mountains fall upon them and destroy them, it is allowed for you, Ya Rasulullah. You give the order and we will do it. And the Nabi alayhi salam turns around and he says, don't do that. Because it might be that one of them become Muslim. And in another riwayah, the Nabi alayhi salam says, Allahumma ghfir liqawmi fa innahum la ya'lamun. Ya Allah, forgive these people because they truly don't know. They truly don't know. Is that enough of rahmah? No. The next thing that Nabi alayhi salam does is he now shows us what should we do after that. What is the objective? What is the focus? Where should I make sure that I prioritize my thoughts and my ideas in the way I live my life? Does the Nabi alayhi salam afterwards turn around and complain about these people? Does the Nabi alayhi salam turn around and make dua against his people? Does he speak bad about these people? In actual fact, he does the complete opposite. He shows us what is the focus and the objective of each and every individual. He turns around and he starts to make dua. But he does not make dua in relation to somebody else, but he makes dua concerning himself. And he says, Allahumma inni ashku ilayka da'fa quwwati wa qillata hilati wa hawani ala nas. The Nabi alayhi salam with blood pouring, he turns around and he says, Ya Allah, I complain to you, Ya Allah, about not them, I complain to you, Allah, about my weaknesses and my ability to call people to the da'wah. My ability to convey the haqq. My weaknesses that I'm not necessarily able to convince them to your deen, Ya Rabbi. And he makes a long dua, and at the end of the dua, the Nabi alayhi salam says, Ya Rabbi, for all of these things that is happening to me, as long as you are not angry with me, I'm okay. As long as my relationship with you, Ya Rabbi, is good, I'm okay. And that's why when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about people that go through trials and tribulations, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we will surely 100% certain Jamaat al-Muslimin with yaqeen. Allah says, we are going to test you with fear. There are going to be times where we are going to be scared in the sense of feeling hopeless, feeling helpless. And it's different types of fear, Jamaat al-Muslimin. It doesn't just mean a violent fear that somebody is going to harm you. You're going to be sitting there in your house thinking, Ya Rabbi, where am I going to get my income? Ya Rabbi, my children need bread tomorrow for school. Ya Rabbi, I don't know whether I'm going to be living. Those that also had contracted COVID. Ya Rabbi, I don't know this and other. That fear that makes you helpless. That fear that makes you hopeless. That type of fear we're going to be tested with. Khawf wal-joo and hunger as well. How many of us experienced that? During this pandemic that we went through, this pandemic was almost as a means for Allah to wake us up. To let us know, people forgot about the masjid. There, Ramadan, no masjid. Alhamdulillah, this year, alhamdulillah, the people came to the masjid. Many people recognized the value and the worth of the masjid. And so, alhamdulillah, the masajid were full to its capacity and, of course, to its limit. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, joy is going to happen. Hunger is going to happen. And you're going to experience loss of wealth as well, loss of money. Money does not belong to us, Jamaat al-Muslimin. The boss is not the person that gives you the money. The boss is but honored that Allah had used him to give you your money. Because that money is rizq min Allah. And the only one that exists that is known as ar-razaq is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether the person likes it or not, only one razaq. Whether the person likes it or not, there's only one generator and one sustainer that sustains us all, Jamaat al-Muslimin. So even when somebody steals from you, according to Al-Imam al-Nafsi, one of the greatest ulama of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, specific in the Hanafi madhab as well, he says that even when we look at rizq, if somebody steals from you, that rizq was meant for them, it was decreed for them, but they decided to take it in a haram way. They decided and they chose, and that's why you will be held accountable for their choice. But Allah had written down everything already. Everything of your rizq has been written. That's why the Rabbi alayhi salam said in another hadith that an ajal will not come to an end unless you have received your rizq that Allah had decreed for you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ar-razaq. And this becomes a reminder when Allah tests us. We don't have money. We don't have wealth. Why are you not turning to me? That is what Allah is trying to remind us. Allah is showing us we are dependent on all of these different things. And we're forgetting that these are not objectives, these are but tools and means for the ultimate objective. And that is none other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. نَقْسِمْ مِلَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ. As well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says He's going to test us with loss of life and people around us. And we don't have to remind ourselves of how many people had left the Jamaat al-Muslimin. Everybody can bear witness to that. We see the numbers increasing of deaths. And besides COVID, there are many other deaths. Nowadays, we forget that, yes, COVID is a big pandemic, but there's many other illnesses that causes death as well. And many people lose loved ones as a trial and a test, Jamaat al-Muslimin. And it reminds me of one of the great stories that Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu narrates. He says, "Anna Aba Talha kana lahu ibn yukna bi Abi Umair." Talha, one of the great Sahabis, he had a son. And he was known as Aba Umair. They called him Aba Umair. That was his if I can put it, a sort of nickname that they gave the son of Talha. And at one period, Aba Talha had left. Some ulama says he went for jihad. And he was gone for a long period of time. But during this time, his son became ill and sick. His son became ill and sick. And the mother is the only one that is with him. And not long after that, the son passes on. child Jamaat al-Muslimin. And the mother of Aba Umair says to the rest of her family, she says, nobody tells Talha until I tell him myself. And so a period of time goes by and Talha now comes home. And as he comes home, the mother, look at the iman of this mother, Jamaat al-Muslimin. Aba Talha comes in and she greets him normal. And she prepares, in actual fact, the riwayah says that she beautified herself for her husband. Because that is what she should do to show that she missed him, that she welcomes him back home. And she does all of these things. And then Talha asks her, where's Aba Umair? And she says, don't worry, he already had what he had to have about eating and so. And he left. But of course, she's not direct with him. And she then prepares his food for him and he sits down and he eats. And he goes to sleep, Jamaat al-Muslimin. And then the next day comes and the mother of Aba Umair, she comes to him and she says, Ya Talha, can I ask you a question? And she says, yes, of course. He says, what would you say if a person borrows something from another household or from someone else, and that individual that owns it, put it back? What should we do? And Talha says, no, we must give it back. We need to give it back. It doesn't belong to us. We don't own it, so we give it back. And then she says, now know that Allah took your son back. Know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took your son back. And that's why when we come to the next ayah, look at the state of mind, Jamaat al-Muslimin. How does Allah describe these people that have sabr, that faces these challenges? قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. That verily from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do we come, and unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is our return. And Jamaat al-Muslimin, with these trials and tribulations, we're looking at our brothers and our sisters that are bleeding in Palestine. Allah will take care of them. Whether we are with them or whether we are not with them, Allah will take care of them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will see to the victory of Palestine. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will see to the justice of the people of Palestine. That is absolutely sure. There's no doubt about that, Jamaat al-Muslimin. But what we need to ask is, how am I going to be honored by Allah in that manner? Because in order for me to give a positive contribution towards, I need to make sure that I'm first worthy of being honored by Allah to be a means of the victory of the people of Palestine. And that's why when we think about ourselves, Jamaat al-Muslimin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. That Allah will not change the circumstance of a people until they change themselves. Where are we with Allah? How am I with Allah? Is my heart in my ibadah? Is my ruh in that ibadah? Am I prioritizing Allah first before anything else? Am I prioritizing the sunnah of the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam before anything else? Because before any jihad took place for the sahaba, for almost 13 to 14 years, Allah first made sure that their iman is strong. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before any battle took place, the Nabi alayhi sallam brought the sahaba the daraja of yaqeen and iman. And so we need to ask the question, do I truly know Allah? Because Allah is the creator. Allah is the sustainer. Allah is the provider. Allah is the protector. And if I need Allah to do any of these things for me, how can I call upon Him when I don't actually know Him? How do I call upon Him when I actually don't worship Him in the manner that I should worship? And that's why Allah says, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. To you, Ya Allah, we worship, and to you, Ya Allah, we ask. But Imam al-Sha'rawi says, take note. Allah first says, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدْ. Your ibadah, then isti'ana. Make sure that the ibadah is strong. Then you can ask Allah for assistance. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant all those that are going through difficulty. May Allah grant them iman. May Allah grant him taqwa. May Allah grant him a victory. May Allah grant him an opening. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant all those that are going through difficult times. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَن يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَل لَّهُ مَخْرَجًا. Who has taqwa in Allah, Allah will make an opening. May Allah grant him taqwa so that Allah can open for them. Inshallah, ameen, rabbil alameen. Once again, we make dua for all those that have passed on and those that are sick. We ask Allah for shifa. And we make dua as well that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants our honorable Imam Sheikh Muhammad Murad that he returns to us soon, inshallah ta'ala, leading us in this beautiful community. Amin ya rabbal alameen. Wa sallillahumma ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa barik wa sallim. Wa akhru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.
Allahu akbar, Allahu akbar. Allahu akbar, Allahu akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم عبده ورسوله أما بعد فيا عباد الله اتقوا الله ما استطعتم فقد قال الله تعالى في كتاب العزيز بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ولنبلونكم بشيء من الخوف والجوع ونقص من الأموال والأنفس والثمرات وبشر الصابرين الذين إذا أصابتهم مصيبة قالوا إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون وعندما أخبرنا النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم عن الابتلاء فقال أشد الناس ابتلاء الأنبياء ثم الأمثل فالأمثل بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن العظيم ونفعنا وإياكم بالآيات والذكر الحكيم أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولوالدي ولوالديكم ولسائر المسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله الحمد لله الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له كان الله ولا مكان وهو على ما كان قبل خلق المكان لم يتغير عما كان علم ما كان وعلم ما يكون وعلم ما لا يكون وعلم ما سيكون وعلم ما لم يكن إن كان كيف كان يكون وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم عبده ورسوله أما بعد فيا عباد الله اتقوا الله ما استطعتم فقد قال الله تعالى في كتاب العزيز بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا وعندما أخبرنا النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم عن أهمية الابتلاء فقال أتعرفوا إلى الله في الرخاء يعرفك في الشدة فلا بد علينا أن نعرف الله عز وجل في هذه الأحوال الميسرة لنا ولا بد لنا أن ندعو إلى الله عز وجل ونستعين به والأحق من ذلك أن نعبده حق العبودية. فقبل أن نستعين لابد من العبادة، وهي مبنية على آية في سورة الفاتحة عندما قال الله تعالى: إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وما قل وكفى خير مما كثر وألهى، وما أنتم بمعجزين. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي: يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد، كما صليت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم، وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد، كما باركت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم في العالمين، إنك حميد مجيد. وارض الله للخلفاء الراشدين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي، وعن الصحابة والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، وأذل أذل الشرك والمشركين، ودمر أعداءك أعداء الدين. اللهم شدد شملهم، اللهم مزق جمعهم، اللهم دمر ديارهم، اللهم انصر من نصر الدين واخذل من خذل المسلمين. اللهم انصر إخواننا في فلسطين، اللهم انصر إخواننا في فلسطين، اللهم انصر إخواننا في كل مكان يا مولانا يا رب العالمين. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. عباد الله، إن الله يأمركم بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله يذكركم ودعوه يستجب لكم، ولذكر الله تعالى أعلى وأهم وأتم وأكبر، والله يعلم ما تصنعون. أقم الصلاة، إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا.
الله أكبر، الله أكبر، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. حي على الصلاة، حي على الفلاح، قد قامت الصلاة، قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر، الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله،
لا إله إلا الله، محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم. سوف رحمكم الله، لا تختلفوا فتختلف قلوبكم، وصلوا صلاة مودع. الله أكبر، الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. فاذكروني أذكركم واشكروا لي ولا تكفرون. يا أيها الذين آمنوا استعينوا بالصبر والصلاة، إن الله مع الصابرين. ولا تقولوا لمن يقتل في سبيل الله أموات، بل أحياء ولكن لا تشعرون. الله أكبر، سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين ولنبلونكم بشيء من الخوف والجوع ونقص من الأموال والأنفس والثمرات وبشر الصابرين الذين إذا أصابتهم مصيبة قالوا إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون أولئك عليهم صلوات من ربهم ورحمة وأولئك هم المهتدون الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر السلام عليكم ورحمة الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله استغفر الله العظيم استغفر الله العظيم استغفر الله العظيم التواب الرحيم الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم ونتوب إليك ونسألك توبة ومغفرة وهداية لنا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا واغفر لنا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم اللهم لا تدع لنا في مقامنا هذا ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا همًا إلا فرجته ولا دينا إلا قضيته ولا
ولا مريضا إلا شفيت ولا ميتا إلا رحمت ولا حاجة من حوائج الدنيا والآخرة إلا قضيتها يا أرحم الراحمين. قال الله تعالى إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله سيدنا محمد وأصحابه وبارك وسلم على إن أولياء الله لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون الذين آمنوا وكانوا يتقون بفضلك دعواهم فيها سبحانك اللهم وتحيتهم فيها سلام وآخر دعواهم الحمد لله رب العالمين.